Thank you, Peter. This is kind of a questionable joke that I have for you today. I debated whether or not it was appropriate. But then, you know, in unity we say what? It's easier to get forgiveness than permission. So, it says, during these serious times, people of all faiths should remember these four religious truths. Muslims do not recognize Jews as God's chosen people. Jews do not recognize Jesus as the Messiah. Protestants do not recognize the Pope as the leader of the Christian world. And Baptists do not recognize each other at the liquor store. Okay. Kind of offends everything in unity, but gotta love it. Gotta love it. So we're continuing in our second week in our series leading up to Easter called Doorways to God's Consciousness, to God Consciousness. And we're looking at some of the teachings of Jesus in the final week of his life when his ministry was fully developed and the inevitability of the way he was to go came into sharp focus. And we're looking at that so that we can engage the power of the resurrection energy for our own lives. And last week I gave you doorway number one, which was to set an intention for something that you want to resurrect in your life. And I said, not an old job or a former lover, but something, not anything outside of you, but something inside of you, some aspect of the Christ consciousness that you want to lift up in your life, something that maybe you've felt dead to or that's been dormant for a long time. And we worked with the affirmation, I intend to open more fully to the Christ spirit of my being. I intend to be or to become, and then you filled it in. Not with something negative like I intend to worry less, but instead it would be I intend to become faithful. Not I intend to be stress-free, but I intend to be peaceful and balanced. You fill it in with the positive quality that you want to resurrect over these next now only 4 weeks. A month from today, I guess, is Easter. And as you've worked with that idea, I intend to be whatever it is, faithful, loving, kind. As you've worked with that idea, what's happened is you've activated a resurrection energy in you. It's beginning to quicken and to stir inside of you, and it's carrying on a requalifying and a redeeming work in your mind. It starts in your mind and then in your heart. And whether you can feel it yet or not, it's begun to pull you now out of that deadness, out of that dormancy, into your fullest potential. And because your mind, as your mind then, changes from error to truth, from worry to faith, from stress to balance, from anger to peace, whatever it is that you're resurrecting, as your mind changes from error to truth, every day, this redeeming, requalifying work that's going on in you causes that thing, whatever it is, to lose its power over you. It's every day some old limitation loses its hold and begins to die away. And you awaken then more fully and more of, you have a fuller complement of the Christ spirit within you. And that leads us to our second doorway this week, which follows naturally after setting an intention, is something's going to wake up in you. Doorway number two is awakening. And you're going to affirm this week, I am awakening to, and then you're going to fill in the blank with that same quality. I am awakening to faith. I am awakening to peace. I am awakening to love. Whatever it is that you're resurrecting in your life, you're going to choose the same aspect in your life. When you say I am awakening, and we're going to work over these next, you know, over this 5 week period into resurrecting this thing, this aspect of consciousness in you more fully and more profoundly, or wake it up because it's been dead in the tomb, you see. So when you say I'm awakening, what you're doing is waking up the life force within you. And that releases a pure spiritual adrenaline that begins also then to move in your mind and in your body, and it has the capacity to dissolve inertia in you. Don't you find when something's not, you know, you've gone dead to something or dormant, it's just like, I can't even lift my finger to help myself, you know. Well, this I Am Awakening is going to activate the life force in you that's going to help blast through that inertia. It's going to dissolve obstacles, and it's going to help you transcend limitations so that you can begin to move more fully into the resurrection energy. Our scripture this morning is from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, and it's 44 verses long, which is kind of long to try to read. And it's where Jesus raised Lazarus, or called Lazarus, out of the tomb and back to life. And I can summarize the story for you, but in it, we'll look at metaphysically some of the most his most powerful lessons. He gives us instructions for how to bring those dead parts of ourself back to life. You know, the ones that you wish, you know, you were better. Just so many people have lulled themselves into depression or a low-grade indifference or whatever that is. And we want to clear that up on our journey to Easter. You remember the story? Lazarus fell ill, and his two sisters, Mary and Martha, sent word to Jesus, who was out of town, and said, "Come quickly, Lazarus is sick and near death." And when Jesus got the word, he just stayed where he was for a couple more days. And then he got word that Lazarus had died, and then he said, "Well, let's go," tells the disciples, "Well, let's go." And he goes back to Judea, and meets with all the people who are, all the professional mourners and all the people that are sad that Lazarus has died. And he walks to the tomb and he calls Lazarus back to life out of the tomb. That's the Cliff Notes version. And we're going to talk metaphysically about what some of those actual things mean. You know, because you're advanced in unity, most of you, that all of the characters in Scripture represent some aspect of our own consciousness. We agree to that. And that each story has a spiritual interpretation for how it fits our life. In this story, and in every story, Jesus always represents your spiritual self, your spirit, the highest Christed self of you. In the story Mary and Martha, women always represent the divine feminine or the feeling nature. That's not sexist. Male represents the intellectual nature. It's the balance of wisdom and love. So Mary and Martha represent the emotional nature or the feeling nature. All of the people wailing and crying and all the professional mourners that they hire when someone dies, those are your thought people. Those are all those thoughts that come through your mind over and over. And you're right in this story, your feelings and your thoughts are suffering and mourning because something precious has gone out of your life. Something that you love has died out of your life, and there's this stirring and this anxiety. Lazarus is a male character, so he does represent the intellect, but metaphysically he interprets as one who is helped by God. And that's very interesting because the key here is no matter how covered over your intellect may become, no matter how intellectually you may be separated from the idea that there is a God consciousness, a universal Christ consciousness, you can never be totally separated from it. God can help you. God can reach you. The Christ Spirit within you can awaken and can become more fully active in your life. But it's your feeling nature. We'll see in the story. This is a weaving of feeling and belief in order to awaken. It's your feeling nature, Mary and Martha, that recognize a part of you is dying. Are you with me? You know that. You feel it. You don't think intellectually, "Oh, you know, I'm angry all the time." You feel that I'm just angry all the time and the happiness in me has died. You feel that. It's your feeling nature. Is the part of you that recognizes something is dying, and it recognizes that it needs to be called back to life. And so it's your heart, your feeling nature, that sends your spirit word, and the word in Scripture was, "Lord, come quickly. The one whom you love is sick." That's what Mary and Martha sent word to Jesus. Now, as we said, Jesus was away in another city, and he gets word, and he assures the disciples right away, this sickness is not unto death. It's so the glory of God can be made manifest. And then he stays where he is. And they're like, what? I love the disciples. They're always like, what? What is he saying? What is he teaching? It's the end of, you know, it's the end of his ministry. And you would think that they'd be catching on by now. Your resurrection journey, this thing that we're moving through over the next 5 weeks, in your resurrection journey, you are not dying. It can seem like a death. It can feel like a death, but it's not a death. It's a resurrection into fuller life. It's a resurrection into more, living more fully from the Christ Spirit within you. What's dying in you is some old way of being. What's dying in you is some habit or some behavior or some way of living or doing that no longer serves your life, that no longer creates happiness or success for you. And it's trying, this new thing is trying to break through. Dorothy Pearson used to say, the reason you feel it so keenly is because it's very near. It's trying to break through. I saw this in this friend of mine, Steve, who 10 years before he made a change in his job, he wanted to. Have you been there? 10 years before you actually make the change, you think, you start thinking, I can't do this anymore. After 28 years as an accountant, he left his job. He didn't know what he wanted to do, but he knew that he was dead to taxes and accounting. He just couldn't put himself through another tax season. If anybody here is an accountant or doing their taxes this week, Peter, yeah, you know, it can be heavy. So he quit his job, and at first the time off felt great. He had fixed all the things around the house that had been deferred. He took a vacation with his wife and his kids. He began to work out more routinely. He read more. He let his body relax. But he still, after time passed, wasn't clear on what he should do. He got on the internet and he searched, but he just, as more time passed, he thought this new change that he was making just felt more like unemployment, you know? And he found that he really had to get back in touch with what he loved to do or who he was or what he wanted for his life, because it had been so covered over with working and earning and providing for a family and living the daily grind that he'd lost touch with his authentic self. And so he knew that he didn't like working with numbers all day. He didn't like working behind a desk. He didn't like working in a cubicle. He didn't like feeling that he wasn't making a difference or making doing anything that really mattered. But he wanted to focus on what he did love so that he could get back in touch with what was important to him. And the first thing that came to mind for him was that he loved animals. He loved animals. And so mostly just to get out of the house for a few hours a day, he began to volunteer at the local shelter. And love began to awaken in him. You know, how can you not work with all those animals? And just love began to awaken in him. And he loved the animals. He enjoyed the staff. He interacted with the vets that were there. He loved them. He even liked washing the dogs and cleaning the cages. Not so much, but you know, it was all a process. And before long, he found himself, that love in him was awakening as he was observing how things were going on. What was awakening him were possibilities for how the shelter could connect more animals to owners and how the shelter could be more effective in the community. And so he called to meet with the executive director to share all this love that was awakening in him and all these good ideas. And lo and behold, there was no executive director. Position was vacant and open for a new executive director. And so he stepped into a work that he loved. And it began by this, what do I love to do? What can I awaken in me? And I mean, there was no way he would know any of that, but that's the power of the resurrecting, redeeming, requalifying energy. It will guide you and direct you. As Peter said in the meditation, there's an omnipotence, a power in God, but there's also an omniscience, an all-knowing mind that will lead you to resurrect the parts of you that need to come more fully into life. If you're resurrecting some part of your life now after maybe a business venture that hasn't worked out, or you've lost your job, or if you're resurrecting your life after a divorce, or you've made a mistake that you just can't seem to get past, If you're resurrecting a new career in a new place, maybe you're retired. I think some people in the room are retired and you want to resurrect new meaning or new purpose in your day. You can awaken the life force within you and call it back into action. And you do that by declaring, I am awakening to new life. Let's put our hands on our hearts and say, I am awakening to new life. Better yet, I am the resurrection and the life. Together, I am the resurrection and the life. Now again, whether you feel it or not, everything in you has just shifted. All of the words, all of the actions, all of your body, all of your thoughts are going to respond to that word spoken in you. Charles Fillmore, our co-founder, said, the raising of Lazarus signifies the restoring of the life idea which is asleep in us. People grow deadened to life because they become covered over with a pathology of defeat, doubt, and fear. Isn't that, find yourself there? I find myself there sometimes. I get covered over with a pathology of defeat, not so much doubt, so fear. It shows up as, I can't, I won't, I couldn't, I wouldn't, I'm afraid, I'm depressed. And then they become buried, or we become buried, in our own tomb of limitations. So, the raising of Lazarus signifies the restoring of the life idea, which is asleep in us, and we grow deadened to it because we get covered over with a pathology of defeat, doubt, or fear, and then become buried in our own tomb of self-imposed limitations. It's interesting that when Jesus received word that Lazarus was sick, he said, we don't need to rush over there. I'm paraphrasing, of course. He said, we don't need to rush over there. This illness is not unto death or something. He reassured the disciples. So he decided to stay where he was. And in unity, that staying, that ceasing of mourning,